book is designed to tell you everything you need to know about the science of getting ahead. Now, let us assume you are young, healthy, clear-eyed, and eager, anxious to rise quickly and easily to the top of the business world. You can.
I can!
If you have education and intelligence and ability, so much the better. But remember that thousands have reached the top without any of these qualities. Just have courage and memorize the simple rules and the chapters that follow. If you truly wish to be among the lucky golden few, you can.
I can't! How to apply for a job. How to advance from the mailroom. How to sit down at a desk. How to dictate memorandum. How to develop executive style. How to commute in a three-button suit with that weary executive smile. This book is all that I need. How to succeed.
Choose the right company. Before applying for a job, make sure you have chosen the right company. It is essential that the company be a big one. It should be at least big enough so that nobody knows exactly what anyone else is doing.
Say, Joe, I got a complaint from our dealers in Cleveland about that last shipment of wickets. They only got half their order. They ordered 300,000.
I know, Mr. Gash, but they wanted two-tone wickets, and we ran out.
Ran out? What is this, a hot dog stand?
Look, we're the world's largest producer of wickets.
Yeah, but we had a breakdown at our eastern plant.
Well, get on the ball. I want to keep Cleveland wicket-minded.
Yes, sir. Mr. Toynbee, any news about the breakdown?
Oh, I'm feeling much better, thank you.
Mr. Tackerberry, did you get my memo?
What memo?
My memo about memos. We're writing too many memos, and it's got to stop.
All right, I'll send out a memo.
The right company! This book is all that I need.
Way.
All company policy is by
common one thing clear. Whoever the company fires, I will still be here.
You certainly found a home. Your brain is a company brain.
The company's washed and now I can't complain.
The company magazine,
toilet style, what punch?
The company restaurant,
every day same lunch. A haddock sandwich, it's delicious.
I must try it
early in the week.
When they run to can.
The hobbies, I'm a hobby. I play chin with Mr. Pratt.
And do you play it nicely?
Play it nicely. Still, he blitzes me in every game like that.
Why?
Because I play it the company way. Executive policy is my mediocre.
How can you get anywhere
you near? Have no fear. Whoever the company fires, I will still be here.
You will still be here
and be here after Fisco. Never take a risk, oh yeah!
Here's a tearing fall. muddy deep.
Where the mud is oh so very, very deep.
Oh, so muddy, muddy deep.
Don't forget, boys, that's
why they call us.
They call us groundhogs. Groundhogs.
Door in gold leaf.
Oh no.
J. Pierpont Finch. J. Pierpont.
Suddenly there is music.
All capitals.
In the sound of my game.
Yes. block letters.
J.
There
must be a way to stop him. There must be
a way. F-Y-S-C-H.
My lifetime program will be more of the same.
The usual spelling.
Remember me, Rosemary. I can't stand it. Whatever happened to Rosemary?
Boy, when you see it on your words I'd like to say.
About what?
Humanity.
whole corporate structure. But beneath our skin, we're all flesh and blood. We're all brothers.
Some of us are uncles.
Now you may join the elves, my friend, and I may join the Shriners, and other men may carry cards as members of the Diners. Still others wear a golden key or small Greek letter pin. But I have learned there's one great club that all of us are in. There is a brotherhood, a man, a benevolent brotherhood, a man, a noble tie and all human hearts divide into one brotherhood. A man, your life of membership is free. Keep giving each brother all you can. Oh, and to proudly in that fraternity, the greatly brotherhood of man. So I want you to remember that, Wally, before you decide to fire Mr. Bigley.
Who's decided to do that?
Oh, I know what's on your mind. You'd like to get rid of the whole crowd, from top to bottom. But stop and think. One man may seem incompetent, another not make sense, while other men seem like such a waste of company expense. They need a brother's leadership, so please don't do them in. Remember, mediocrity is not a mortal sin. There
is in the brotherhood a man.
Yeah. words will come in an easy way. Round in circles I go.
Thank you. happy, Nick?
Yes, Paul. I really like the way you dance. No, I mean it. So I figured we'd try this again. For one thing, if you're going to change your name, why go from a Puerto Rican name to an Italian one?
Because I don't look it. People say, you don't look Puerto Rican. You don't look Puerto Rican. But I am.
So you figured you looked Italian?
No. Just wanted to be somebody new, so I became Paul San Marco.
Why did you want to become somebody new?
Why? I'm not really proud of my past.
Who is? But that's what the word means, Paul. Past.
That's easy for you to say, but...
Look, wait a minute. What made you start dancing? Your parents?
No. What do Puerto Ricans know about theater? Now they have Channel 47. And they didn't have anything. And my father loved the movies. And he'd take us all the time. He worked nights. And when he'd come home, he'd take us down to 42nd Street. We'd come out of one movie, go into another movie. I don't know why, but I loved musicals.
How old were you?
7 or 8.
On 42nd Street?
Yeah, it was a trip.
Go on.
Well, I had to sit down front. Because I couldn't see. I wear contact lenses now, but I'd move down front. And these strange men would come and sit beside me and play with me. I never told anyone because I guess it didn't matter.
Why didn't it matter?
Why?
Look, Paul, if this is too rough for you, I have your picture and resume.
No. Okay. From seeing all the movie musicals, I used to dance around on the street, and I'd get caught all the time. Man, it was so embarrassing. And I was always being Sid Charisse. Always. I don't understand why, because I really wanted to be an actor. I mean, I really wanted to perform. Once my cousin said to me, "You'll never be an actor." And I know she was telling me this because I was such a sissy. I mean, I was so feminine. I always knew I was homosexual. What bothered me is I didn't know how to be a boy. One day I looked at myself in a mirror and said, "You're 14, and you're a faggot. What are you gonna do with your life?" At this time, I was in Cardinal Hayes High School. There were 3,000 boys there. I didn't have any protection anymore. There was no homeroom where I could be charming or funny with the tough guys so that they'd fight my battles for me, like they did when I was in smaller schools. I liked school, but my grades got to be so bad. I mean, even if I knew the answer to a question, I wouldn't raise my hand, because I was afraid they'd laugh at me. They even whistled at me in the hallways. It was awful. Just awful. Finally, one day, I went down to the principal's office, and I said, "I'm a homosexual." Well, this was a Catholic high school, and at age 15, you just didn't say that. Well, the principal said, "Would you like to see a psychologist?" So I did. And the psychologist said, "I think you're very well adjusted for your age. And I think you should quit school." So I quit school. But I didn't really want to. It's just, I couldn't take it anymore. See, when I quit school, what I was trying to do is find someone who was like me and how to be a man. And you know, there are a lot of people in this world who don't know how to be men. After a while, I found out that I was one. I was just looking for the wrong thing. I was trying to learn how to be butch. Anyway, I hung around on 72nd Street, meeting all these really strange people, just trying to find a friend who was like me so that I'd know what it was that I was. Somebody said that there was they needed male dancers down at the Jewel Box Review, you know, the drag show. So I go down to audition from all these years of pretending to be Citrice. I had this fabulous extension. I mean, I could turn and do almost any move the very first audition. They didn't care anything about my dancing. They just looked at me and said, "You're too short to be a boy. You want to be a pony?" I said, "What's that?" They said, "A girl." I said, "What do I have to do?" "Show us your legs." "I've got hair on my legs." "That's okay. Come on upstairs." So I go up to this filthy rat hole where they hike up my dungarees, shave my legs, put nylon stockings and high heels on me. It was freaky. Then he took me back downstairs and said, "Oh, you have beautiful legs." I said, "Really? Terrific." So I didn't know what to do, but I knew one thing. I had to hide this job from my parents. That was something, because I had to buy all the stuff, like shoes to rehearse in, earrings and makeup. I hid it all, but my mother found it. I told her there was a girl in the show who didn't want her mother to know what she was doing, and so I was holding it for her. She believed me. Here I was in show business. It was the armpit of show business. But it was a job. I don't know. I told my parents that I was a dancer in a show. Not what kind, of course. They couldn't stop bragging. I had friends, but after a while it became so demeaning. I mean, nobody at the toolbox had any dignity. Most of them were ashamed of themselves and considered themselves freaks. I don't know, but I think it was the lack of dignity that got to me. And I left. Well, I muddled around for a while. I worked as an office boy and as a waiter. But without an education, you can't get a good job. So when the Jewel Box called me and asked if I'd come back, I went. We were at the Apollo Theater on 125th Street, doing 4 shows a day with the movie. It was really tacky. Our show was going on to Chicago. My parents asked me if they could bring my suitcase down after our show so they could say goodbye. I don't know why. I said, okay. We were doing this Oriental number, and I looked like Anna May Wong. I was in this slinky dress, and I had these 2 big chrysanthemums on either side of my head, and this big headdress with gold balls hanging all over it. I was coming down the stairs for the finale. When who should I see at the stage door? My parents. They got here too early. I shrieked. I didn't know what to do. I thought to myself, I'll just go by them quickly and they won't recognize me. Everyone else was going by them quickly. But just as I got to my parents, I heard my mother gasp, "Oh my God, well, I died." Well, what could I do? I had to go on to the finale. So I just kept on going. After the show, I went up to my dressing room and took off my makeup and put on my street clothes, wondering if they'd still be downstairs. And there they were, right in the middle of all these freaks. You should have seen my parents. They didn't know where to look. At least my mother had the guts to look me in the eye. I could tell she'd been crying. She said, "Make sure you eat good." My father couldn't even look at me. He just said, "Take care of yourself," and they turned to go. But before they left, my father turned around and went over to our producer, and he said, "Take good care of my son." And that's the first time he ever called me that.
Never did see before. I walked and came to see on a Friday. A Saturday I learned a thing or two. Cause up to then I didn't have an idea of what the modern world was coming to. I counted 20 gas buggies going by themselves almost every time I took a walk. Then I put my ear to a bell telephone, and a strange woman started in to talk.
"What next?"
"Yeah, what?"
"What next? Everything's up to date in Kansas City. They call about as early as they can go. They went and built a skyscraper 7 stories high, about the size of building on a broad. Everything's like the dream in Kansas City. It's better than the magic lantern show. You can turn the radiator on whenever you want some heat. With every top of comfort, every house is all complete. You can walk to privies in the rain and never wet your feet. They ain't gone about as far as they can go.
Yes, sir!
They got a big theater, they call the Burlicue. For 50 cents you can see a dandy show. One of the girls was vacuum picking pretty. Around the globe, but she was around the world. I could swear that she was padded from her shoulders to her heels. But later in the second act, she began to peel. She proved that everything she had not been. She went about her as she could go.
Yes, sir, she went about as her as she could go.
What you doing, Bill?
This is a two-step. It's all we're dancing nowadays. Catch on to it? A one and a two and a one and a two. Of course, you don't do it by yourself. Come on, Aunt Ellen.
Some
$100 cash. Now you name the date.
August 15th.
August 15th? Why August 15th?
That was the first day I was kissed.
Was it? I don't remember that.
You wasn't there.
Now, looky here. We gotta have a serious talk. Now that you're engaged to me, you gotta stop having fun. I've been with other fellas. You gotta be a little more standoffish. When fellas offer you a buggy ride,
I'll give an imitation of a crawfish and dig myself a hole where I can hide.
I hear how you've been cutting up some capers when I was back in Kansas City, Mo.
No.
I hear some things you couldn't print in papers from fellas who've been talking like they know.
What? I only did the kind of things I ought to. Sorta. To you, I was as faithful as could be. For me, that story's not the way I love my bloomers. Rumors, a lot of darkness and a monody.
The whole thing don't sound very good to me.
Why, you see?
I've grown so my life while I cut out all shenanigans. I see my money don't gamble or drink in the back room down at Flanagan's. I give up lots of other things that a gentleman never mentions. But before I give up anything else, I want to know your intentions. With me, it's all or nothing. Is it all or nothing? It can't be in between. It can't be now and then. No half and half romance will do. I'm a homecoming type, all complete with slippers and top. Take me as I am or leave me be. If you can't give me all, give me nothing. 'Cause nothing's what you'll get from me.
Not even something.
Nothing's what you'll get from me.
I'll be braver. Sooner or later, I'm braver than you.
No, you're not.
Yes, I am.
No, you're not.
Yes, I am.
No, you're not.
Yes, I am. Yes, I am.
Talk out to my white tiger tail.
sorry.